then this is the group I went into the museum with, because we had a split up, because one, it was small spacing, so not all of us could go at once. Another, very emotional, and they wanted us to take it in without having a bunch of people around. And so they wanted us to be able to spread out and just kind of take it all in and let it, because it was really hard. That was probably the hardest, one of the hardest days, was going through that museum.
For sure.
That was in a different group.
Yeah, we were split up. Sure. We took groups with, these were groups that we had throughout the whole week.
And yeah, because we, our name tags had little dots on them, and colored the dots in the group you were in.
Yeah, and so.
We also split up in groups to have conversations, and my group got off topic so much. We were talking about feminism, homelessness, all these other issues.
Which was good, because, you know, teenagers need to learn about everything, and that is one. And that's what this whole trip was about, not just, of course, mainly around the Freedom Ride, but also so many other things that are happening now and have happened before that are going to be happening soon. So it was, yeah. It was
yeah, there was a girl from Botswana in my group, and she talked about the very traditional values that her culture has. Like, boys do not cook unless they want to be considered gay, and you do not say that you are gay. It's not talked about. You don't even suggest that you are. There's no touching in public. Even if you're a man and woman, you don't touch in public. You don't talk about love. It's very, sort of euphemism-like. You have to use, be very careful about what you say. And, you know, like, there aren't very many safe places for gay people. Like, university is probably one of the only ones.
That, and of churches, of course, who support anyone who is gay or just doesn't, you know, fit in. And so, yeah, it was really interesting to see, you know, because we had just made the law that, you know, gay marriage is legal everywhere.
And they were
and
like,
whoa. Why? No,
how are so liberal.
Yeah, it was, you know, interesting to hear how they, like, you know, even if they had a friend, if they could not. They were really not against it themselves, but didn't understand it just because they've never been open to it. Their parents never talked about it. Grandparents, women are very, you know, at home.
Very traditional roles, traditional gender roles. There's this, the girl who has this one brother that's the only male in the family, and he knows how to cook. So, and he's been called gay before, and she says, well, he knows how to cook. That's a good skill to have. You should be called gay for that, so.
Yeah, it's really interesting to hear how, like, here, you know, it's both, like, equal man and woman cook.
More or less.
Yeah.
So we can still make improvements ourselves.
Yeah.
There's your pictures. There's more for
these are the three men, or four men, and then these are supposed to be, like, representing their footsteps. It's right outside the museum. Really cool. That picture down there, again. But this was right outside the museum when we first pulled up in the bus.
Yes, you can tell the reflection.
Yes. This was some more singing, and then this was my workshop group, which was really fun.
And this is in the airport in LA, and it was 10 at night.
We were waiting for our plane.
You can tell that we were so happy and excited about this.
I was charging my phone, it was like 5%, I needed to take pictures. And we were kind of just starting to get to know each other because no one knew anyone except for Rachel. We knew each other, and then we knew Bishop Barry, of course. But yeah, so we were just kind of getting to know everyone, knowing where they came from and how old and stuff. And then this was lunch.
And on the last day, we left with some lunch. It was a gesture of love and appreciation.
Yes.
I would have died without that
lunch. We're also the earliest group to leave. We left with the South Africa. And Boston.
Yeah, we left with them and everybody else.
Because they had to leave early too, because they had an 18-hour flight.
No, it was a 13-hour flight.
13. It was 18 coming because they had a delay in New York.
Yes.
Yeah. And they came. They were here for like a month before us because they stopped in New York.
Yeah.
They stopped in New York for a couple of weeks, and then they came over just because it was their first time in the United States. So like, why not? You can't, you know, come to a new place and just stay for a week. It's, yeah. Extra pictures. These were rooms.
And this like house. And this one that wasn't altered at all. Yeah, yeah, it's in general state.
Yeah, and so
these are actually really nice houses for slaves because most of them were basically these
mud floors.
Sort of half hearted attempts at a house.
Mm-hmm. And the only reason they put like actual floors in was because people were dying. And they're like, we can't have our property dying. It'd be like, you know,
that investment.
Exactly. So they didn't do it for the slaves, they did it for themselves. Extra pictures. Oh, this is the actor. Mike was his name, and I'm forgetting his last name right now. And then this was dancing. Bishop Curry.
Yes, he's human. He likes this.
Yeah. Our whole group, second day later, I believe.
Yes, that was the day it rained really hard, and I thought there was a hurricane coming through. I'm like, why did I hear about this on the news or something?
it was crazy.
Yeah, it was so wet. There were frogs hopping across the sidewalk.
Yeah, and like snakes.
And I thought those were baby birds at first. Somehow fell out of the nest, and I'm like, oh wait, that's a frog. And so we were all sitting out there staring at the rain. And everybody's like, you're from California, aren't you?
This was the time where we were in our big drought, so we hadn't seen
and
it for a while.
And fires, our state was on fire.
Yeah, and so we were like, this is so great, we should just push it towards California.
Take it home with you.
Yeah.
It's still like a rain.
Exactly.
Sorry.
And that night, I believe, was the thunderstorm. And
yeah, it was
lightning had struck like a mile away from where we were. Mm-hmm. It was kind of scary. I'm not a fan of thunder lightning, but it was pretty. It was
awesome.
Very pretty to see. It was like purple.
But you probably heard all of their phones receive the warnings.
Yes, they were like, oh my gosh, there's going to be a storm. And we're like, what?
Because the storm was going to actually happen. And I'm like, oh.
We were all trying to worship where it was happening. So everyone's like, oh, it's God speaking to us.
What is your greatest takeaway from that week?
Well, we really have to work at the racism and prejudice thing because it hasn't gone away. It's just more subtle than it has been in years past. And you need to realize that we all have our own hidden prejudices, and once we realize what they are and where they are, then we can start to overcome them.
Why do you think it's taken so long over all these years?
Because there's resistance to change. People don't like to change. It's scary.
Or
it's better the devil you know than the devil you don't.
Yeah. Or hear other people's opinions that they don't agree with, so they kind of just block it out. And like, nope, my opinion's what's staying.
Yeah. Especially if you're ignorant. If you're not educated, then you don't know what it's like for other people, because you're just in this little bubble where you just know people who are like you, and you think that's the way the whole world is, and it's not.
Did you have the opportunity to talk about the justification of slavery and oppression from a Christian perspective or a perceived biblical or even gospel perspective? Were there people talking about
some point there was the justification for slavery when there was Noah, when his son caught him naked and he's all like, oh, I curse you, you shall be slave to your brothers because you did this and you saw me naked, and it's like, oh. And then the person's like, yeah, this naked guy who's drunk is totally a great example, and that's why we should do this. And that was basically the entire justification for slavery, was that particular passage, that Ham was to be slave to his brothers, and that's the way things were.
When we came back, I hadn't really, acknowledge that I've seen everything I've seen, because it was really hard. It was probably for a lot of people, but emotionally it was really hard for me. The museum I said we saw, we went through this part, what was it called? The Shattered Glass Room.
The Hall of Shame.
Hall of Shame, and the pictures, the way they were presented, it was shattered glass on the wall, and it was very intense pictures. The last one we saw was Emmett Till, the picture of when they found him afterwards, so it was really...
It's very rare to ever find someone who's been lynched, because usually people just disappear and they're like, whatever.
Yeah, it was after they had dragged him out of the river. And then I've heard this story before, because I'm homeschooled, so I am able to pick what I want to learn. And so for the whole semester before I went, that's all my dad and I talked about, was just that period of time. And so we had researched Emmett Till, and we had learned, and I learned that his mom wanted an open casket. At the funeral, her exact words, so everyone could see what they did to my baby. And it really affected me when they explained that and then showed the picture, and I was like, oh, and I didn't really process it until a week after we came back. And it was really intense because everyone who knew I went were like, oh, what happened? Like, how did you feel? And like, I felt really like, I couldn't feel what I felt because I wasn't able to like sit down and actually feel it. And so I know now that it really did affect me in a positive way also, nothing negative, but positive, but also changing. So I was really glad I got the opportunity as a young high schooler to go and experience this with other, even younger high schoolers, and then come back and able to share with you guys and our church. We went to Crescent City, and then even my friends who aren't, not religious, but just, yeah, not religious, I guess, and shared to them, not on the religious side of the part, but on the, hey, we need to make a change, you know, we're the new generation. And we talked a lot about how we should, how the adults were saying we need to listen to the younger kids, even if they are young, they know what they're talking about, and they're the ones who are going to take over as us.
That's the mess everybody else has made.
Yeah, and so they talked a lot about that on the trip.
And when I came back to school, we were also learning about civil rights in my history class. And in English, we were reading Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.'s works. So I got to do that all over again, and it's, we got into more detail and had to take tests on it. And I'm going to have to take this big test in May that's going to have a lot of stuff on it because I'm an IB student and we all have to take that test.
Doesn't it help you to look at it in a whole different way than probably some of the other people sitting in the room?
Yes, I probably have an advantage over them because I have been on this trip and I have seen a lot of this stuff firsthand. So I did already have a sort of sense of what it was like. But really the whole blood and gore part of it didn't really sink in until school started, because that's when you start to learn about everybody who died, and not just some of the people, like important people like Martin Luther King Jr. or Malcolm X or something, somebody like that. But like all the little people, like those four little girls who were killed in when the 16th Street Baptist Church was bombed. And you learn about people like that, people who didn't really have names, who weren't really important, but they died anyway.
And in the museum, they had a big wall of just all the names of everyone that they have seen or have heard of that died. And so Martin Luther King was on there, but also the four little girls.
And there were a lot of clergy on there, mm-hmm. a lot of priests, a lot of people of faith.
And that was really interesting and also kind of heartbreaking that so many people of every, you know, gender, race, age, I mean.
Yeah, it just didn't matter because it was.
Who's ever supported is the ones who.
I mean, like, even if you were white, you weren't safe.
Yeah.
In fact, in some ways, that was worse.
Mm-hmm. And then at the very end of the museum walk, there at the last stop we had was all the pictures of just everyone, millions of people, all formed President Obama's face, and they had put that in when he was elected president, and it was really cool to see that that it really affected a lot of people that the first African American president had been elected, and so they didn't think it was going to happen this soon, that it was going to be in the future. So it was really, really interesting to see that.
Also, we did have some time, some sort of free time while we were there, and so I made this little cross thing as a reminder of some of the lessons we learned in North Carolina, mm-hmm. and we made lots of these, so.
We made one for you guys to keep here, or
I know.
Just to remember that.
Yes.
And then I have a small announcement that's for me. Rachel won't be doing this, sadly, but this is a 3-year program, and next year it's in South Africa, and we're going to learn about their history. And I am going to apply to do that. Unfortunately, Rachel is not going to be able to do it, but
I don't have a passport anymore. It expired.
But I have talked to my parents, my church. I've been in touch with Bishop Barry, and hopefully, it's going to be a very small group, 50 to 22 people. This was about 70, about 90 altogether with all the adults. And this year, it's going to be under 30 with everyone.
Because the facilities are small.
Very small.
Everything's
small. And then also traveling to South Africa is very expensive for everyone. But I am going to try. I will probably be doing something like this by myself when it comes closer.
Also, I did hear of a more local pilgrimage that Mr. Barry's going to do in California.
Yeah.
I don't know the details of that. I'm not sure I can go to that even because I'm trying to get a job because I'm going to college. college next year, and that will be an issue, but I will try to do that, and then I can come back and talk to you guys about that, too.
Yeah, and as South Africa, I will be in contact with you guys, and probably will come back before I leave, and just maybe, like we did before the summer, and also afterwards, but we'll probably come back and just ask for you guys' support again, and I'll keep you guys in contact. Hopefully, I will get accepted for that because I really want to go. But South Africa itself.
Next summer?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, and I'll be gone. The whole pilgrimage will be from the 3rd to the 10th, I believe. But I will be going a week earlier, hopefully, to be just a host family will have me because you can't, you know, like I said, you have to really experience it. And then afterwards, for another week, Beth Crowe is going to put together some kind of extra fun, you know, thing, like, you know, kind of a relax yourself, you know, don't take it all in all at the same time, maybe like a safari trip or something. So,
it's really beautiful where they're going to stay, because we saw pictures there while we were in North Carolina. This is in this green area right next to this big mountain, and there's hiking and animals, and I'm like, I want to go, but I can't.
It's called Cape Town, South Africa.
Oh,
it's the place, yeah. And so they want to take us on morning hikes, and there's a tabletop mountain, there's a lion head mountain, what they call it. It's
I'm just thinking of the jet lag.
3 weeks, so by the second week, I'll be used to it, and then I'll get
by
another.
3 weeks, you'll be used to it.
Yes.
You know, by the time I come back, I'll be like, yay, I want to say more.